Skywalker.
It doesn't even make any sense. He's dead.
No, because there's loads of Skywalkers.
The whole entire family is dead.
Yeah, you're right. They're all dead except for Kylo.
Maybe put this name before this particular episode. Like, any episode before this one would be more suitable. Not this one. He's look, he's next. He's next. Everyone's getting systematically murdered. He's on the plate next.
There are things left to ruin. There's still stuff they can ruin.
We can bring anyone back and ruin them. You don't know the extent of the power that we have.
Palpatine's message was apparently, at last the work of generations is complete, the great error is corrected, the day of victory is at hand, the day of revenge, the day of the Sith. That's what was broadcasted in Fortnite, and apparently that message is what they're referencing in the title crawl. I just love the idea that Poe is like, you guys play Fortnite? He put out a message.
I have been playing Fortnite for 36 years, mastering my skills.
That's why his fingers are so fucked up.
The actor for Palpatine was like really into the idea of coming back, and I know it's obviously because it's just fun for him and everything. Do you think that when he came in day one, he was like, how am I alive, by the way?
By the way, how is this possible, me being here and everything?
Like, it's cool, I'm here, I'll do the scenes and stuff, but like, how?
Yeah.
And then JJ's like, yeah, it's nothing. I honestly think that conversation happened where he was like, there's not something you need to worry about. It's so unnecessary. Chad, you could just attack them normally.
Your swordman. How practical is that?
How practical is moonwalking in medieval warfare?
Yes.
we need to know.
I can't even say how bad.
I have this image of his cult followers pumping out a Snoke clone.
No. He's not ready. His face is all messed up. We need more time.
He has now died. He's got vaguely menacing stuff to say.
Didn't you read the novelization? They explain this. He wanted him all fucked up so no one could tell what race he was. Unironically, that's
makes
what he
a
says.
Joke.
I have been every voice
you have ever heard inside your head.
What a huge revelation! Let's never mention it again.
Okay, so what was Snoke? And he's like a puppet test tube thing. Like, okay, so what? You made him because he's like, you know, to take over, I guess. And you're like, take over what? How? He's like, I mean, you're asking too many questions. Stop it.
The idea came up of, well, what if Palpatine lived on in some way? Within about 30 seconds of discussing that idea, we just knew that it was the right idea, because we knew that this has always been a story of Skywalkers and Palpatines.
It's a generational story. I mean, the idea of the story of these grandchildren grappling with the same things that their predecessors have dealt with. It just felt poetic. My favorite scene from the prequels, Palpatine telling Anakin the story of Darth Plagueis the Wise and his obsession with cheating death, and it sits there like the greatest setup of all time.
Somehow Palpatine returns.
I love that line.
He's just the audience somehow. I don't fucking know. He's back.
I just love the delivery. In the last he seems so fucking done with this movie. Rip Rian Johnson's dream. I like that this is a metaphor for JJ repairing the Star Wars franchise.
Funny just to think that JJ's like giving a giant middle finger to Rian right now.
I have died before.
Okay, so he's a zombie?
Dark science. Cloning. Secrets only the Sith knew.
Wait, so he's a clone?
Many abilities some consider to be unnatural.
So he's immortal. Which the fuck is it?
In 16 hours, attacks on all free worlds begin.
Find Exegol. Find the Emperor.
No.
The fuck you mean no? Come on, Leia, what else were you training her for? Ninja warrior?
So they assemble a crew of Finn, Poe, Chewie, C-3PO, and Rey, but not Rose. Rose can't come. She's busy. I know you were all wondering, but what about Rose? Will she be coming? No! Rose will not be coming! She's fucking busy!
Knights of Ren.
How should we communicate to the audience that these masked figures are the Knights of Ren? I know. When they appear on screen, let's have a character go, huh, it's the Knights of Ren. This is the kind of expositional dialogue that should only be in your script if it's labeled placeholder for when we write better dialogue.
This fleet, what is it, a gift? What is he asking for in return? Does that matter?
He says, what does he want in return? Kylo just kills him. He's like, why the fuck did you do that?
No, that's a really valid question.
Like, you're just gonna give us this shit for free?
Why are they even there if you're not gonna listen to their questions? What's the point of them?
You said words, death now.
Death.
Well, do you think, like, JJ got to that point in the script and he's like, fuck, I can't actually think up for an explanation for this.
I think it's a running theme. I think it's a running theme for the whole series. Like, that doesn't make sense. Throw it off.
Kill him quick before he keeps asking questions.
Rey and Co. fly to yet another desert planet. The Star Wars galaxy is just packed to the brim with sand.
It's funny, though. Yeah, because the joke in my head was like, he just goes, hi. But the one that he does in the film is, Palpatine wants to kill you.
Oh. Rose, you're welcome to Chili's. What can I do for you today?
Bad news.
What?
The Dacia Sandero. It's delayed.
Oh no. Anyway.
I've located the resistance fugitives. All units report to the...
He's suddenly killed by a mystery arrow because Stormtrooper's armor is made out of fucking styrofoam.
Kylo ends the Skype call by ripping the necklace off Rey's neck. He tracks the necklace to its planet of origin and uses that to figure out where Rey and the crew are. Given the First Order have patrols stationed on this place anyway, why not just have one of them see her and then report it? No. That would be too simple and would make too much sense. Why would you have simple cause and effect drive the plot forward when instead you can have the plot being driven forward by a character being given a necklace at the exact time that they need to not be wearing a necklace?
Oh, they fly now!
They fly now!
They fly now!
Man, I fucking wish Rose was here.
I'm sure none of them have ever seen something so unique before.
In the latest Rise of Skywalker clip released, the group realizes that the Stormtroopers have jetpacks and can fly now. What was your first reaction upon seeing that?
They fly now!
He forgot.
But what if that was the first time they used them?
They've been using them since the Clone Wars.
The quicksand deposits them inside a bunch of tunnels underneath it. The sand magically doesn't deposit itself into the tunnels because sand is nice and gentle and doesn't get everywhere.
I like sand.
Bones. I don't like bones.
Poe sees the skeleton and goes, oh, bones. I don't like bones. As if he doesn't kill people for a living.
When the delivery guy calls up Palpatine and says, hey, I'm here to drop off the necessary raw material required to build 1,000 Star Destroyers because I assume your scary lightning planet doesn't also have a robust mining operation, does Palpatine tell him,
to get to Exegol, you must first locate a Sith Wayfinder?
Okay. Where do I get that?
To locate a Sith Wayfinder.
Hey, if you're gonna kill people, please do it with a map that leads directly to my secret hiding place.
They are attacked by a sandworm, or, well, not really. They have a standoff and the worm just sort of looks at them for a while. The thing is like, hey, heal me? Question mark?
No idea why.
That was a TIE. I think that was a TIE. Do you guys think that was a TIE?
No, that was,
I think
that was a TIE interceptor.
Oh, shit. Sorry.
Sorry, what is she doing?
Why is she facing the wrong way?
Why is she doing that?
Ray.
I think you're gonna outrun that thing, right?
Ray, it's not worth it. Ray, just walk to the left or right.
Well, he's fucking dead.
It's fine. It's not even a scratch on him or his clothes. He looks immaculate. What the fuck? Why did any of these things happen? Ray is shocked. Oh no, Chewie! Oh, so now explosions kill people, do they? Like, I don't know what she's making a fuss about. I'm sure he'll be fine. Oh, what, he is? God damn it, fuck, I was joking.
All right, let's fucking begin. The entire team allowing Rey to waddle off that far was just silly. Having her commit to this fucking move rather than simply throwing the lightsaber from a safe position is just silly. Having the First Order parked right next to our heroes and doing nothing about them? That's just silly. Having Chewie go to chase Rey while taking Uchi's knife with him instead of leaving it with Poe and Finn? That's just silly. Having Rey be unable to pull the ship down or just straight up damage the thrusters is just fucking silly. She's a god. Having neither Poe nor Finn do anything about the troopers or Kylo Ren or this escaping ship is just silly. Having Kylo Ren survive being fucking exploded after rolling a million miles an hour is just fucking silly. Rey using one of the most advanced powers for the dark side without a lick of fucking experience in that regard is fucking silly. Having Rey blast out concentrated gay to incinerate Chew fucking Baka though? Fucking really? You insipid piss waffle. That series of about 2 minutes was just fucking silly.
We recovered the scavenger's ship, but she got away. It brought back a valuable prisoner.
Prisoner?
Oh my god, it's that character! Oh my god, that character's not dead!
Oh my god, it's Robert Downey Jr.
There's more of us.
Poe got so much screen time, it's so funny.
I wonder if he got more screen time than Ben.
He did.
There was definitely like more lines for sure. Yeah, and yeah, I guess he did get more screen time.
Hey, remember when that ship got blown up 20 minutes ago? Not only did Kylo survive the ship blowing up, the ship also survived the ship blowing up. We know this is the same one because Rey later finds the mysterious triangle in the glove compartment, which is still there from when Kylo was using it to navigate to Exegol at the beginning of the film. The movie seemingly destroys something on screen, forgets it did that, and then has it show up again a few minutes later.
We're looking for a prisoner and his belongings.
All right, so go ahead and tell them to release Chewie. Or not.
Ray, come on.
The dagger's on this ship. We need it.
Why?
A feeling.
Huh?
The last time she had a feeling, she ran off to play with Kylo and supposedly killed Chewie. So maybe you guys should try to stop her.
I'll meet you back at the hangar.
Ray, you can't just...
Or not. Stormtroopers are so fucking useless. Holy shit. Oh.
Thank you.
pushed you in the desert because I needed to see it. I needed you to see it, who you are. I never lied to you. Your parents were no one.
So instead of going with the idea that Kylo was just wrong about Rey's parents before because he didn't know the truth, they've decided to present this to us as if Kylo was never lying, he just wasn't telling the whole truth. This is what Kylo told Rey.
They're filthy junk traders who sold you off for drinking money. The dead in a pauper's grave in the Jakku Desert. You come from nothing. You're nothing.
Yeah, no, that wasn't true. They weren't drunks who sold their daughter for drinking money. They were being hunted and sold their daughter to protect her. This movie acts like all he said in the last movie was, your parents were no one. But he said a lot more than that and clearly implied a lot more than that. And that's not even mentioning the, let's call it, awkward truth that Kylo wasn't even the first person to say Rey's parents were nobodies. That was Rey.
Do you want to know the truth about your parents? Or have you always known? You know the truth. Say it.
They were nobody.
Kylo wasn't even the first one to say that, so he's now saying, hey, remember that thing that you said? I wasn't lying when you said that.
Tell me where you are. So that's where you are.
Actually, I'd like to do this myself.
You're gonna let somebody else at the worst time.
I'm the spy.
What? You? I knew it!
No, you do not.
You don't just have power. You have his power. You're his granddaughter. You are a Palpatine.
Have you been keeping Rey's secret from the beginning? Did you know about the parentage? Like, tell me about that journey of when you found out.
No. At the beginning, there was toying with like an Obi-Wan connection, and then it really went to that she was no one. And then it came to episode 9, and JJ pitched me the film and was like, oh yeah, Palpatine's granddaddy. And I was like, awesome. And then 2 weeks later, he was like, oh, we're not sure. So it kept changing. So then even I was filming and I wasn't sure what the answer was going to be.
If Palpatine's your grandfather, who exactly is your grandmother in that scenario?
You tell me, Josh.
Your father was the son of the Emperor.
One of her parents was the child of Emperor Palpatine.
I never lied to you.
What do you mean you didn't lie, Kylo? That doesn't make any sense. One of her parents was the child of Emperor Palpatine. Mr. Johnson, I'm so sorry, but I can't stop laughing at how much JJ must have hated your movie.
Hang on, you've just...
No, I like it. This is brilliant. But I like this.
I see. Get me the Supreme Leader.
Yes, sir.
It was at this moment that he knew. He fucked up.
But wait, wouldn't killing the supposed suspect make Pride look super suspect? Not if you don't think about it.
Hold on, is that the Death Star?
That's, yes,
that's
it is.
The Death Star, my friend. That's the Death Star.
Why are they looking at the Death Star? Because they're no. at... No.
I was waiting for Wolf to pick up on that.
No.
Have we mentioned in enough detail how bullcrap it is that the Death Star survived impact? Like
oh, of
this?
Course, yeah. Oh. Of course it slipped my mind because there's just so much other shit.
I mean, like it obviously blew up into nothing.
Most of it would have been vaporized with that explosion, but any chunks that were left over either would have,
what are the odds
would have been
would
tiny. If anything that big did survive, if it hit Endor like that, it would have destroyed the planet.
Yeah, we're talking
you know?
Like huge
it'd be a crater.
Massive
this
chunks.
This thing is the side
yeah.
of
like,
a moon.
A moon. That impact would have destroyed the whole planet. Well, it wouldn't make a planet destroyed. It would have caused such a crater.
It would have caused a lot
sent
of
so
havoc.
Many things
a
into
tidal
the
wave,
atmosphere.
A tsunami.
But I've got the scene from the battle. I'm going to pull it up.
Just
exploded,
screenshot it. Just give
okay,
a screenshot.
I'll...
Yeah, what you do is get the frame where that big chunk flies away from the rest towards the planet. Yeah,
Don't forget to zoom in so you can see Palpatine surfing it.
This is all we need to just know that this is absolutely not possible. There's no way. Look at that. There's no way.
No, it's fine. Palpatine's in there and he's alive right now.
Oh, all good. You've got everybody, all the heroes celebrating on Endor, and they were there for a little while, but they never seem to recall any giant impact.
Would have impacted the planet with the force of a few hundred to thousand nuclear bombs, sent up so much debris into the atmosphere that would have caused a nuclear winter that...
Not to mention all of the energy cells or power things inside that thing that just... Who knows what kind of damage that'll do.
Interesting thing with meteorites. The larger the meteorite, the more energy that's released on impact. The big meteor craters, you never find the meteorite that causes the bigger craters on Earth because they get vaporized into nothing from the impact, okay? Small ones can kind of survive because the impact isn't as devastating. But larger ones, especially anything as big as the Death Star we're looking
at. Yeah, how would it keep together? There's no way that it would keep together.
It would have vaporized itself on the impact with how destructive it was.
Also, how did Palpatine survive landing on the planet? Did he take an Uber or did he just crash straight
in?
He surfed the Death Star. Why does everyone have trouble with this?
And it just happens to be in the correct orientation.
And then she uses the Force.
It's not upside down.
Or underwater. Imagine if it's underwater. It's like, well,
yeah, if that's in the ocean, it could be a mile underwater part of it. Man, lucky it's still, you know, there, you know.
Also, that's an interesting question. How come the Death Star isn't like scorched from burning through the atmosphere?
And if anyone even tries to say that parts of the Death Star in that chunk were still operational and it was able to use thrusters or anti-grav to lower itself down, no. Okay? Don't even go there.
This is fucking bullshit.
No, we gotta stop thinking. We're getting into the red. But how did this planet even fucking survive getting hit by something so gargantuan and indestructible? My brain, I can't stop it.
What is that?
It's the Death Star. It's a bad place.
We came across a really big issue in that it is completely ridiculously huge and found out that it was about 90 miles across. It's too deep to fit in the ocean. It's too tall to fit into the atmosphere.
Completely ridiculously huge and found out that it was.
So we found out that we could just barely fit the dish way out on the horizon. That we're pretty happy with. And JJ looked at it and he kind of said, it's a little too convenient that we just happened to come across the dish. So we kind of reset. Maybe you would have just a piece of the shell with a little bit of the dish left in there to hopefully recognize it as what it is.
What?
It's gonna take us years to find what we're looking for.
Oh, damn.
Good luck finding your chaos gem, kids. Work's cut out for ye. Oh, no. No, 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 no. No!
We picked up a transmission from someone named Babu Frick.
Babu Frick? Oh, he's one of my oldest friends.
Have to get to that wreck.
There's only inside there we need.
I can take you there by water.
See the water?
Not now. Too dangerous. We can go first light tomorrow.
We can't wait that long. We don't have the time.
Or the choice.
Is it just me or is more than 16 hours gone by at this point?
It's an 06, but should work.
This is a first order part.
There's an old cruiser on the West Ridge. The one we were assigned to.
Huh?
The one we escaped in.
Okay, wait. You were First Order?
Not by choice.
We were conscripted as kids, all of us.
I never knew there were more.
Deserters. All of us here were stormtroopers. We mutinied at the Battle of Enset Island. They told us to fire on civilians. We laid our weapons down.
All of you?
The whole company. I don't even know how it happened. All of us here were stormtroopers.
We just assume that it happens. But no one else is in the room where it happens.
Ben.
I mean, it says right in the script, forget the past. Kill it if you have to. You're doing a pretty good job.
Forget the past. Kill it if you have to. And I said to Carrie, they're doing a pretty good job. First Han Solo, now me. If this is a pattern, you're next, right?
Leia dies because she's a mother or something. What is up with the mother hate in this series?
Hey, remember Force Heal? Yeah, this is why we set that up.
For the first time, someone had shown him what I think maybe he perceived as a huge act of generosity in spite of what he had done. Someone like kind of reached out when no one else had for a long time. Someone like kind of reached out when no one else had for a long time.
Not exactly sure of what that means, other than please be good now, you fucking idiot.
Goodbye, dear princess.
Ever thrown his lightsaber into the sea because it's an evil color?
Boom.
Did he pick it up?
No.
Did he leave it on the planet?
I don't think, no, because the red things that fell in his quarters, they didn't stay there. And the next shot, it was a zoom out shot, and those red things are no longer on the floor. So I think that anything that falls into the Force connection doesn't stay there. I think it's temporary. It's there, but it's not there. It's happening for their senses, not for permanence. But for the object.
He uses the lightsaber later.
Oh.
At no point did I say it's the planet, that the planet is connected to the Force and that Force ghosts can interact with the physical world. They don't say that, okay? Yeah. The direct implication is that Force ghosts can just do this crap
I mean, why would it be that planet when Luke went there specifically to cut himself off from the Force? Why would he go to the planet that's super Forcey, where ghosts can even use the Force if he wanted to escape the Force?
It may not be that the Jedi originated there, but that's where they established their first
temple. Is that how that works? You just, when the Jedi said, this is the first temple, it went boom, and Force ghosts permanently have power there. It's like, that's how that works?
That's okay.
Maybe they built it there because of the Force energy on that planet.
Fuck off.
Well, yeah, because Obi-Wan died on the Death Star, but he showed up on Dagobah and all that stuff.
He showed up all over the place.
On Hoth. Yeah, man.
But then Luke showed up at Tatooine, you know. You can go anywhere as a Force ghost, so you should go to Exegol and summon lightning and destroy the fleet.
Yeah, this is why I joked about it before, but I say it again. What's the point of being alive?
Yeah, I mean, you're...
The Jedi's weapon deserves more respect.
Master Skywalker.
There are too many of them. What are we going to do?
Leia Saber.
It was the last night of her training.
First of all, I think she died in space, meaning she somehow came back to life.
Okay, that's so not that's proven, but okay.
The Force can resurrect people.
I'm pretty sure that's not true, but...
It's not unbelievable to think that Leia, in her old age, has done some kind of meditation or trained with...
No, that was confirmed by Rian Johnson. She's not done any training. He actually countered that rumor.
He said it was instinct. He said she did it on instinct instead of an actual skill.
Sure. Just want to clarify, she has no training with the Force.
She has no training with the Force. No.
Similarly to Rey, she just summons these abilities.
Because I wasn't so knowledgeable, I still have questions about what it all means. Like when people talk about Jedi and stuff like that, I remember having a conversation with one of our executive producers on Seven, Michelle, and I said, but surely Leia's a Jedi. I still don't quite have my answer. Like, is she a Jedi? I don't know. Does anyone know?
Well, I said you have that power too. So that's
no,
never...
she's not a Jedi.
Okay.
All right.
There we go.
What do I know?
George Lucas stumbled into a powerful Leia without meaning to. Leia didn't need to use a lightsaber. She didn't need to be trained. She was powerful. Because of course she was. And that's all they needed.
Because she was a powerful woman. She was a strong woman.
She was a general.
She was a
princess.
Hope.
She was everything. She was everything that we would want to be.
And she took the pain of everything that she had ever experienced it and turned it into hope. But now she is something different with this lens.
Ghost Luke pops in and gives Rey Leia's lightsaber. But she's already got his. Is Rey gonna be given everyone's stuff? She gets all your sabers, she gets your fucking ships. The only thing this bitch has of her own is a stick. A fucking stick. A fuck stick.
No. This movie puts such a disrespectful, horrible nail in the coffin of that, which is related to the very next thing that Luke does. He raises the X-Wing out of the water and it still bloody works. This was a point in which I got more angry than any other point in my review, because that means in the previous movie, Luke chose to commit suicide.
Exactly.
And
he could have gone to Crate, but he didn't.
Exactly. If that shit worked, he could have gone physically and actually done something more substantial. But instead, it is now canon by this movie that Luke decides to give up and commit suicide. That is the ultimate statement against one of the most beloved characters in all of fiction.
I could save my sister. I could save the Resistance. I could confront Kylo, who I should want to after all of these years. I could do all this stuff, but nah, I'm just gonna create a mild distraction and die.
The only defense against that implication was that he had no other choice because he was stranded there. The ship didn't work.
We covered a video on a previous EFAP that said that that ship was waterlogged and so he couldn't have used it.
RIP. Well, didn't they try to backtrack and said he was searching for something instead?
He explicitly says he came there to die.
Yeah, but then in this movie, he said they were searching for something, and that's what the Jedi texts were. They were puzzle pieces to find Palpatine again, right? Isn't that
right, but he gave up. He was searching for it, and he found Uchi's ship, and then he just went, oh, fuck it, there's a droid in here, but never mind, let's go.
She's going to Exegol.
In the novelization of Rise of Skywalker, we apparently learn that Rey repaired and rewired Luke's X-Wing using parts from Kylo Ren's TIE fighter. How the f*** long did that take? You try going to a mechanic, tell him, hey, I've got a 1979 Ford Fiesta that's been rotting under the ocean for about a decade. How long you think it would take to get that running again? Like 15 minutes?
Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you J.J. Abrams trying to make a high-stakes final battle scene.
They can't activate their shields until they leave atmosphere.
Even though the war at the beginning of the fifth movie began with the Empire trying to destroy a shield generator that was protecting a base in the atmosphere of a planet. Oh my god, who wrote this? And it's about to get so much worse. What would stop the Death Star destroyers from just going up above the atmosphere? They'll get their shields back and there's still like 1,000 of them. Well, Poe has an answer for that.
Ships that size need help taking off. Nav can't tell which way's up out there.
Nav can't tell which way is up out there? The ships can't tell which way is up. Fucking up. How about you look out the fucking window, you turbo cunt? How the fuck would they not be able to tell how to go fucking up? If nobody could tell which way is up out there, then everyone is fucked and the fight can't even take place, so I guess this only applies to the big ships, which sounds like shit. If you guys can tell which way is up, then surely they fucking can. They have windows. So then how is it that only the big ships don't have navigation out there? They have the same, if not superior, technology when compared to the smaller ships, so that just smells like shit. You just need to go in the opposite direction of gravity. Can we please get a helium balloon for each Star Destroyer in case our pilots can't look outside?
So how do the ships take off?
They use a signal from a navigation tower like this one.
Oh god, it gets worse.
They can't go up without navigation from a tower.
At best it's implied. They never state it's because of Exegol, but they do say beforehand that Exegol is a mess. It's got gravity wells and lightning spikes. They say that to justify the navigation, so no ship will be able to navigate in this. They won't even know which way is up. And you could just look and look, well, where's the ground? Yeah. That way is up.
It's right? Like it's the nature hard. Of gravity should tell you, like,
our ship tends to fall when we go this direction. That's weird.
And it makes you wonder, what exactly is on those ships' computers? They don't even know what way is up. Like, why is it so big? Like, what is it? What's the point?
They then say that you won't be able to open shields in atmosphere. And so best faith interpretation is that it is implied, only implied, that shields can't be used on that planet.
Which means Palpatine needs to push these ships into above atmosphere immediately.
Yeah. Why are they sitting in the atmosphere then? Just raise them up a bit and you're fine.
I hope this goes down as being like most embarrassing thing eventually. Once everyone's talked about this enough, that ships can't go up in this film.
Imagine the fucking stupid helicopters. Like, we can't go up until we have coordinates. Like, all you do is go up from here. What are you talking about?
It's like you're standing on the deck of the ship. Just look up.
We can see that there is space to go up. Just trust me, go up.
Like, there are people on a bridge looking outwards at the ship.
Do you like the idea, by the way, that they would prefer to opt to be destroyed than try going up themselves?
You have a 50% chance of getting it right.
It's like, guys, may as well just risk it all and try going up.
Yeah, it's like, also, the direction that we came from, that was down. See, let's just go the other way.
But even if gravity was like telling you up was in a different direction, all the ships are in line that their bottoms are facing the surface. Exactly. You don't even need gravity to tell you. Just move the ship in the direction of its top and you'll reach space.
Yeah, go from the way you didn't come from, because the way you came from was underground caverns.
Do you love that Palpatine could just force push them up?
I would just love to see the bridge crew of these Star Destroyers having this argument. Yeah. Like, about which way up was.
Like, no, up is that way. You
the bottom of the ship is down. You go the opposite way from that.
You're fucking it up, Frank.
How do they not even figure it out? They're standing.
The poor helmsman's just like, I don't understand.
Like, well, up is the ceiling, so just lift us up.
All right, we'll figure this out. Ships 1, 2, 3, and 4, you go in 4 opposite directions. The survivors can tell us which way it is up.
Building the most impressive fleet in the history of the galaxy, and I can't even figure out how to go up.
Someone in chat said, they don't go up now. They don't go up now.
We gave every one of you guys a planet-destroying cannon, and you don't know which way is up.
Like, you guys need to sort your priorities.
But thank God we got this fancy red armor.
They can't escape the planet. You're like, what? How stupid is this enemy team?
Okay, a single enormously convenient oversight that the good guys can exploit to obliterate the bad guys. Nothing new to Star Wars. An exhaust port, a shield generator, a woman, and this time a direction. Up.
Mary then asks whether they can do a Holdo maneuver. They named it after her, holy fuck.
We need to put some Holdo maneuvers.
Not a bad idea, Mary.
do some real damage.
Come on, that move is one in a million.
One in a million? One in a million? You're telling me that what she did had a one in a million chance of working? She was just astronomically lucky. What do you fucking mean? Doesn't that make her a traitor now? If it was a 999,999 chance out of a million that she would escape into hyperspace, then isn't that the obvious fucking thing she was trying to do and she got unlucky?
You have bet the survival of the resistance on bad odds and put us all at risk?
By her own judgment, she's now a twat.
Just look how the First Order react to it. Doesn't seem like they're reacting to something that only has a one in a million chance of succeeding.
And if she knew that it was a low chance, then why didn't she just drive the ship into them the regular way?
Like ramming someone
right.
is the, really basic.
Just driving your car into another car, it'd be like, you wouldn't say the chances of you hitting it are one in a million. You wouldn't even say one in a hundred. You'd just be like, yeah, it's kind of binary.
That's where Lando and Chewie come in. They'll take the Falcon to the core systems. Send out a call for help for anybody listening.
Leia's call went fully ignored last time, but this time they figure Lando has some actual charisma to make it work. Luke standing down the First Order by himself wasn't enough to motivate all these aliens to get off their asses. But a booty call from Pando?
I still can't believe this entire plan comes from a random droid they found on a 20-year-old ship in the fucking desert. Kill me.
First Order wins by making us think we're alone.
We're not alone. Good people will fight if we lead them.
What our mothers and fathers fought for, we will not let die.
I just want one soldier in the background to go, my father fought for the Empire?
And so, the Rebellion fleet follow her to Exegol. She doesn't wait for them, and they don't wait for backup, because... As soon as the fleet arrive, they are bombarded with what seems to be thousands of lasers, and they make it out okay for a while. I don't know that that's possible. In fact, I think it's very not possible at all, actually, but okay.
Help is coming!
There it is.
Wait, what was that?
There it is.
One more time.
There it is.
Got a visual on the tower.
I'm sorry. I need...
I see it. Got a visual on the tower.
General Pride then discovers their plan, and so he reroutes the ship's navigation to his own ship to guide them out. Wait, what? He can literally guide out the ships with his own ship? Because unlike the other ships, he knows how to fly up this fucking script.
The nav signal is coming from that command ship. That's our drop zone.
How do you know?
It's free real estate.
That signal is coming from that command ship. That's our drop zone.
Nav system from the air.
They drop Finn, Jonna, and some nobodies on top of the destroyer to let them run for it. On horses. Yeehaw! In response, the Final Order just banks the ship a bit and slides them off.
Pride is bewildered by this. He has no idea how to stop it. Try tilting the ship! They have horses, you pancake fuck. You have artificial gravity. They don't. Tilt the ship. And even if the gravity somehow applies to them outside of the ship, it is worth tossing your crew around if it means saving your entire fleet, for fuck's sake.
You make an announcement on the Star Destroyer.
We are about to lose everything. We are turning off artificial gravity and we are spinning this bitch. If you don't hang on to something...
Hold on, yeah.
You know what someone will say then? But sir, which way's up?
Just spin. He's like,
how do I spin?
Hold right.
Which way's right?
For fuck's sake, Frank.
It's right up. It's up right. I don't know.
Any direction. I don't know, man.
Just spin.
I'm nervous. It's my first day. God.
How is do you this fucking stupid? We then see them all get attacked by Sith troopers, because why not? With the amount that land, it's over. There's no way they don't wash over the very small number of rebels as is, but oh my god. Shrek is here. Yes! Shrek made it into the scene. Good for you.
You will be Empress. We will be one.
We're offline, sir. Reset the navigation signal.
No, wait, listen. The Crown Cannons have stopped. They're resetting their systems.
Look, they're powering down their cannons. They're resetting the... How do you reset a tower that's been exploded? How does that work?
We gotta hit them ourselves.
What can we do against these things?
Just stay alive!
Wow.
Oh, wow.
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 Strike me down. Take the throne, and the fleet will be yours. Good.
Why? Where am I? Am I still in my house? Is this still my hair? Is this my hair? What's going on?
That's right. He finds an operational TIE fighter, can take off and fly directly there from memory. This ship survived. This was upright and ready to take off.
No look kill, like father, like son.
She will draw her weapon.
And now she takes the lightsaber and she does it's like, what are you doing?
Oh yeah, he's kind of like Snoke when Snoke was like,
and he kills his enemy.
Two hours later.
If Palpatine is the one who did the whole force connecting thing, wouldn't he have known that they were a dyad?
That's actually a good point. Like, how would he be unaware that they're a dyad when he's the one who connects their minds and stuff?
Because, like, he doesn't know until the very end, right? When they show up and he's like, a dyad. Like,
huh?
He
didn't know
a dyad in the force.
He was unaware of the Force Dyad. Even Kylo says he's unaware of the Force Dyad. Remember, he's shocked. He's like, oh my god, a Dyad of the Force. Oh my god. Oh my god, my fingers, they're growing.
Now I can jerk off some.
With the fingers growing back, something else must have grown back.
Oh god.
There has been an awakening in my pants.
Now that's what they mean by the rise of Skywalker.
Oh my god.
I need like 10 minutes, I'll be right back.
So long, Sky Trash.
Who's that flyer?
Take a guess, Spice Runner.
She's not dead, and neither is Babu Frick.
Why is no one staying dead in this fucking movie? It's just this little person making this stupid shout sound in a ship with a person whose whole planet was destroyed with no feasible way for her to escape. Chewie, C-3PO, Babu, Frick, Zora, Bliss, Palpatine, everyone just dies and comes back. I can't with this. He gets red clothing once he's rejuvenated. I love the idea that they were on the floor, like, knocked out, and he walked off to his, like, bedroom, and he put on some new clothes that came back.
He's like, oh, what would work in a situation like this?
I can't wear all black. All black's just not.
Sith be looking so fly.
I have to put on this red cloak to celebrate my erection.
Comes back out with sunglasses on.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how fly am I?
In the prequels, we learn that Qui-Gon is the first Jedi to learn how to manifest his consciousness beyond death. His training was incomplete, so he couldn't become a Force ghost like Yoda and Obi-Wan later would, but by all accounts, he was the first Jedi to learn how to manifest after death. So, how did all of those other Jedi Knights manifest their voices after death? It kind of lessens Qui-Gon's importance, and that's a big shame.
So, on one hand, only Force ghost trained people can do it. But on the other hand, no, maybe it's all Jedi. In which case, there should be a thousand voices going, Ray, 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 Ray. She'd be like, shut the fuck up, one at a time.
Why didn't the Force ghosts come back to help Luke when he was getting lightning to death by...
They knew Anakin had it. They knew Anakin had it. Even though they also knew that they were like, Anakin celebrated, is like, you didn't kill him, he's fine, what are you doing? Go get him, you haven't finished him yet. You realize, when she was unconscious on the floor before she'd woken up, if he had just, like, fucking exploded her head, film's over. Yeah. Qui-Gon Jinn is like, Rey, you need- oh shit, she's dead. She blocks galactic fleet destroying lightning with her lightsaber. You gotta love, like, again, with the whole sort of trying to mend this trilogy, she's like struggling, she's bleeding, she's like, oh, I gotta do this. It's like, I'm sorry. It's ridiculous. You killed the Emperor, fuck's sake. There is no amount of struggle.
And the way that they show it is so dumb, right? The Emperor just showed that his Force lightning can take out a galactic fleet. He unleashes the full force of that lightning power onto Rey, and she blocks it with a single lightsaber. No! Yeah. No.
She's got no power left. He sucked it out of her.
She would have overloaded and exploded the instant that lightning hit for how powerful it was, and she should have just been fried to death. Like, there is no
okay,
logical
chance. Okay, fair enough. But what about two lightsabers?
Take
that and double it.
And instead of it giving him a ball bag for a face, it disintegrates him. They do the move that Mace Windu did to him, and it's like, wait, but that doesn't kill him, does it? And it's like, no, it does.
Yeah, but she had two.
Two. Yeah, that was Mace Windu's mistake. He didn't pull out the second lightsaber.
Mace, pick up one from one of your fallen comrades. Ah, shit.
Palpatism slowly melts to the point of my wondering what the fuck he was doing still firing lightning at Rey when half of his face is a fucking skeleton. Hey, Palpy, why don't you stop? Stop it.
I'm not sure it's actually his, because she does like a little like push and there's more lightning coming back.
Fingers are still going. He's still zapping.
Yeah, there's still lightning coming out of him. I guess we could argue that she's like simultaneously reflecting and powering up as well, I guess.
Okay. Whatever.
I mean, why not? Lightning is not strictly a dark side power anymore. It's just a power, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, like, electricity powers... my microwave, and that's good.
I also love the fact that they do a close-up on his face as his entire body disintegrates. As if they're trying to show you just how hard he's dying. This time he's dead, we promise. As if you could possibly kill him harder than he was already killed before.
We've talked about it to the point where it's like more normalized, but like just rewind even a year and talk about the fact that like Anakin didn't kill the Emperor, Rey is going to. You'd be like, what are you talking about? That's not possible. He's dead. What are you talking about? It's like, oh, you're in for a fun ride, person.
Remember that time when Luke actually couldn't kill him and Darth Vader had to do it because he was that powerful?
We've also just been told that if Rey kills Sheev, then Sheev wins by passing on his consciousness into Rey. But then Rey just kills him anyway, because this establishes a precedent that anything can happen at any time for no reason, just because the writers think it would be neat. At the end of this film, he gets completely disintegrated by Force Lightning, but when you can survive this... Who gives a fuck how dead it seems like you are? Because the precedent is no longer if we explicitly show the audience that the character is dead, that means they're dead. The precedent is now... And it undermines the sense of finality that this movie is clearly trying to have, because now nothing's stopping them from bringing Sheev back in another 10 years after he was disintegrated, with roughly the explanation, I escaped that too. Because that's the precedent now.
There you go, the saga will end. It's like, yeah, until someone else decides to staple on another fucking three films.
I'm all the Jedi.
Fuck. She really is the Jedi Avatar. It was supposed to be a joke, but now it's a whole thing every fucking time. I swear they're lifting imagery and elements straight from the show, too. An underground bunker as an all-out battle rages above. The good guys have a tight time limit and must exploit the bad guys' weakness. A confrontation of family, dual-wielding swords, the lightning redirection. All that's missing are the accompanying tension, good writing, and soul. Kylo climbs back out of the hole because falling down an endless pit doesn't mean jack shit in this galaxy.
Oh no. Oh no.
Why is she kissing?
They just met today.
Why? What is this fever dream?
He dies after that. He just disappears. He's dead.
The virgin Ben Solo gets so excited that a girl is kissing him that he apparently has a heart attack.
Healing has massive implications, okay? They not only screw up how it's employed, that, you know, what cost is there to heal? Because it doesn't cost Rey anything. She heals,
nope. And
she's perfectly fine. But when Kylo heals, he kills himself. Because reason, okay? There is...
Rey and Kylo finally share their first kiss. But Rey sucks out his fucking soul through it. Here I felt a great disturbance in the Force, as if a million voices suddenly cried out in anger and would not be silenced. Kylo pieces out because he's a true Jedi, unlike Rey, who stuck around to be revived like a Sith.
We should do some real damage. How about some Holdo maneuvers? And Finn says, nah, come on, that's like one in a million.
What in a million what? Like, what's the risk?
That is contradicted in the end of the movie where you see someone doing the Holdo maneuver.
Yeah, but that was just a million people tried, but that was the one that...
But as the celebration continues, I can't help myself wondering, so is that the First Order gone too? Did they just forget about the First Order? At the beginning of this movie, apparently they were still at war with the First Order. This movie introduces an entirely new threat, Sheev and his Final Order, which is what gets destroyed at the end of this movie. So, what happened to the First Order? Remember the villains of this trilogy? Apparently Pride Star Destroyer being destroyed, and Kylo turning to the light side, and Hux being shot means no more First Order? Man, the fact that the main threat for this film, the last film in a trilogy, was something entirely new that they introduced, well, not new, you know, stolen from a better trilogy, but new to this trilogy, it hadn't been set up at all in the two previous films, just goes to show how disjointed and disconnected these three films are. The faction that this entire trilogy was supposed to be about defeating just gets sidelined for the final part and basically ignored. Not even this trilogy cares about this trilogy.
When she pulled it out, I was like, what is that? I tried to look at it and I don't recognize this. It looks Leia. I was like, oh yeah, that's right. Leia has a lightsaber because she was trained by Luke and she beat Luke in combat. Yeah, she's great. She's really amazing. I love Leia so much. She's great.
She is my favorite lightsaber wielding character. Rey checks out her new lightsaber, a custom one that she made? Okay, why weren't you using that one instead of Anakin's? What, what?
It takes so long as well, there's like, hello? Hey!
I was saying to Rags, like, she would have seen her bury those lightsabers. Once Rey walks off, you imagine she was like, oh my god, lightsabers.
Yeah.
Show how much money this is worth is crazy.
Who are you?
I'm Rey.
Rey who?
She's like, what's your name? She's like, oh, Rey. She's like, what's the other part of your name?
Rey what? I need a last name.
How am I supposed to address you?
Who are you?
I'm Rey.
Rey who?
Okay, bitch, listen up. You don't need to do this, okay? Just don't do it. Don't say the stupid thing in your mind right now, okay? Don't do it.
Who are you?
Move on, bro. Move on. Hold back.
I'm right.
Once in your goddamn life. Hold.
Ray, hold
back. Hold back.
Ray Skywalker.
She just steals Skywalker because obviously she doesn't want her name to be anywhere near Palpatine.
It'd be funny if like Luke and Leia over there are like, what? Wait, what? Back up. Fuck, what?
How dare you?
The obvious thing to say is that at the end of the saga, the Solos are dead, the Skywalkers are dead, and the Palpatines win. It's like, wow, okay. Jeez. You know, you just have that second, you have to sit down and be like, oh. Why? Why did you want this? Sadly, if you look at the saga as a whole, you watch the prequels, you can kind of just... Can I just skip the OT? Like,
oh fuck.
Well, yeah, right? Because nothing happens.
Like, what do you need to see the OT for if the only goal is to understand how Palpatine is ultimately defeated? It's like, yeah, you don't really need that part.
Fuck, you can literally skip the OT. yeah.
Thanks for the time save,
fact,
Disney.
Does it make more sense if you skip the OT? Because then you don't find out that, like...
These characters don't seem as...
No! You know, it would have made...
Right!
It would have made...
Right!
So
it makes more sense without the
It's like, what do you mean these characters are inconsistent if I see this OT you speak of?
Yeah, because if you see like, the OT, then you don't you see how work. Like then you don't and see how like... Palpatine dies. It's like, oh, you know, maybe he was just like stabbed through the chest and he healed himself or something.
Yeah,
you
the
don't
OT,
see
then.
Han Force becoming ghosts a better the... person. Like, it doesn't matter that Han is now a crappy smuggler anymore. It doesn't matter that Luke Skywalker...
You don't see Han at all.
Because it's the original series that makes the new interpretation of these characters so dumb and inconsistent. But if you remove the
yeah,
original series...
And plus, everything to do with Force Ghost being able to summon lightsabers also makes more sense. You're there watching, you know, and you're like, why doesn't Obi-Wan just Yeah, it does. It really does. It basically makes
it destroyed Star Wars.
This is why the sequels will always be worse than the prequels, because the prequels don't deal anywhere near this much damage to the Star Wars series, but the sequels, like, pretty much undermine everything that the original trilogy did, not only in terms of what actually happened in the plot, but also a lot of the themes of the story.
Are you a part of this? Did you do this? How dare you? How dare you, all of you?
So did Palpatine intend for Rey to tell the rest of the Resistance where the planet was so that they would come and attack him?
It sounded like it, right? Remember, he says, come to me on Exegol, the girl is coming, whatever, and his friends will follow her.
Especially if your fleet couldn't get into the atmosphere, why would you want to fight them there? You knew that they wouldn't be able to raise their shields for some fucked up reason. Why fight them in that condition?
Oh, are you saying why would Palpatine want to fight them there? Yeah, I agree.
Especially now everyone will know where... I mean, assuming there's at least one rebel to tell everyone else where Exegol is now, then that becomes common knowledge. It's like, oh, so much for the secret Sith planet.
Yeah.
What a stupid person.
So they're transferring the message about Exegol so that it can't be detected via the line, but who would care?
Oh, that clearly didn't work because the guy who did that ended up with his... Yeah, he's fucking dead. Also, why didn't he just toss him a USB? That's wireless, too.
I was about to say, he could tell him. He could go, hey, dude, Exegol's real.
It was encoded as well, and obviously it was sent to them somehow to give to R2-D2, so it seems like it was already sent wirelessly to somebody.
This actually does not make sense, not whatsoever, and I love the fact that he got killed anyway. It's like he takes all these precautions, he just dies. Remember when Rey's lightning destroyed an entire ship and Palpatine's lightning only turns the ships off and messes with the controls? Yes.
But she didn't even mean to do hers, though, so...
Yeah, it makes sense. He was trying to destroy them while she was only accidentally destroying it.
Yeah.
That makes it better.
There's a thing, by the way, how believable this is, but apparently they fucked up the title when they first released this and changed it immediately, but it originally said Skywalker. it's just Luke with his eyes all fucked up. Skywalker.
Luke with Down syndrome.
So you'll be sitting,
One of the background players is none other than the granddaughter of Sir Alec Guinness. Sally Guinness, right here. Sally.
Action!
It's just very exciting to be here.
Isn't it crazy?
Yeah. I've gone to the dark side, apparently.
Isn't it sad what's happened?
Every time I think of that scene, I think of the... And he falls down and then... And I'm like, and he's alive. Explode. Like, all that sound, the soundtrack, it finally calms down. Vader's looking down the hole, you just hear...
Ow. Asshole.
I'll be back.
Like, calls an elevator from down there. It's like, ding. He's like, coming off, you ass.
I've lost you, boy.
Remember when movies were cool?